It is Good Friday. And in keeping with the somber traditions of Good Friday, it's a gloomy, gloomy day, raining and drizzling here in Sacramento, and it's going to rain, I think, all weekend for a while. We've got another one of those atmospheric rivers. At least it's not a bomb cyclone. I hope. Anyway, yesterday I was reading from a 1989 diary, okay, 35 years ago, about this time of year. And it concerned mostly activities that Constance and I were involved in our capacity as OTO lodge masters and our involvement in governing bodies such as they were back in 35 years ago. And yesterday I mentioned that part of what was going on there is we helped celebrate Phyllis Seckler's, or Phyllis McMurtry Seckler, her 50th anniversary in the OTO. So she had been, if my calculations are correct, she was initiated in around March 18th. That's I'm not sure of the date of her initiation, 1939. So 1939. And it was a wonderful celebration. We enjoyed it very much. And she was an absolute wonderful, wonderful lady. And for a while, my direct supervisor in she initiated me, she and Grady, into the OTO. And she was my AA contact for a long time. But anyway. And I bring it up because next year in 2025, the OTO will have its convention. I believe it'll be in Portland. I'm not sure. That'd be nice. And I will be celebrating my 50th anniversary because I was initiated Minerval in 1975. I said yesterday that I may read on a little bit more in my diary, and I'm going to share with you another little adventure from the diary today. It's not so much that I expect it to be interesting to you from a any other point of view, then it's just Lon hoping that somehow the words that I wrote 35 years ago might not be completely lost to the sands of time when I'm dead and gone. At least I'd like to share this little episode of our lives, our magical lives, and in this particular case, in the OTO that took place 35 years ago, about this time of year. And this is called Our Trip to England and Wales. Now, Constance and I were asked by Hymenaeus Beta, the Frater Superior, or we referred to him as a caliph at that time, to to initiate quite a few of the higher degree, then higher degree members of the European members at large and members of the groups in formation in Europe, and that included people from Norway and Sweden and Germany, and what was then just collectively known as Yugoslavia. And then, of course, there's Irish and a lot of them. Okay, they needed 5 degrees, which is there were very few initiators that had experience with 5 degree initiation ceremonies, which are very elaborate, very, very beautiful. It's a lot of preparation to do it to do it properly. It's one of the most breathtaking and beautiful initiations in the OTO, and Constance and I had the privilege of doing quite a few of them in the United States. So we were tapped to go to Europe and initiate quite a number. I don't know the right offhand the number, but the initiation itself took 10 hours. That's just doing the initiation. It took preparation, which I'm going to sh share some of those details with you, along with the comedy of errors of our life. So this is April 4th, 1989. This is Tuesday. We're still in Costa Mesa. We're having a heat wave, 96 degrees in LA at 10 a.m. Constance loves this kind of weather and is not only anxious and nervous about the trip, but reluctant to leave home in weather like this. She has left Jean-Paul with packages of lunches for all 10 days and many notes around the house for maintenance of himself, the cats, and the house. And remember, at that time, Jean-Paul was already, I think he was 17 or 18 years old, and had served as deacon. Remember, we talked about that yesterday. 11 a.m. Mom and Bud. Now that's my mother and her second husband, who that was named Bud. Arrived about an hour ago, and delivered their color TV so Jean-Paul can have something to watch. Ours is broken. As a matter of fact, until that time, we never had a color TV. It's always black and white. Mom very crabby at Bud. They take us to the airport. Now that's about a 40-mile drive from Costa Mesa up the freeway to LAX. We left for the airport around 1 p.m. and on the way, a bottle of water that Constance had in her purse broke, and got our tickets, our passports, her magazines, and everything in her purse wet. I was furious and snapped at her because I was wound pretty tight at the time too, especially sitting in the car with my crabby mother. And snapped at Constance, terrorizing Mom and Bud. We dried her purse by sticking it out the car window. It was 100 degrees by then. We dried the tickets and passports as best we could. It was snowing in England, actually. Okay, that's the next thing. Wednesday, the 5th, London. We got to the airport a little after 2 p.m. and got our luggage checked in. To save $70, we carried on an extra bag we thought we could ship. The flight went well from my point of view, but Constance was very uncomfortable the whole way, especially after we're over the ocean. I was thrilled to see the Northern Lights as we were over Greenland. We arrived around 1 p.m. London time. I couldn't even get Constance to look out the window at the northern lights. And I had no idea before this trip that she would be that uncomfortable. Anyway, poor thing. She's a much better traveler, but always over the water, we have to walk on eggshells. Okay. Heathrow was a real trip. Over an hour in line to get our passport stamped, but customs didn't even stop us. Now, if Brother Clive Harper is watching this, this is where we first meet Clive. Okay. We were met by Clive Harper, who held up a sign, 93 Duquette. Very pleasant. Not at all like JP thought, Jean-Paul thought. So before we left, Jean-Paul made mock predictions about the British OTO would be elderly people with goat leggings, lecherous, satyr, goat legging people, old Crowley contemporaries, a million years old and still very frisky, you know. It's very Clive was very pleasant, not at all like JP thought. We drove about 20 miles to High Wycombe to his house. Nice street of brown brick. I don't know what to call them. They're not houses and they're not apartments. Sort of like the houses in San Francisco, where the whole block is Victorian houses and that touch each other. Clive's house, like the others next to him, has 5 stories of one-room floors. It's very nice, but a lot of stair climbing. Okay. Clive has long since moved from there. Clive is obviously highly evolved as he laughs at my jokes. He's been in the order for many years. His wife, Deborah, is very nice and they made us feel very comfortable. I called the boss, that's Hymenaeus Beta, who is in London, and asked him to go to Grand Lodge of United Grand Lodge of England headquarters of the Masons. They have a regalia shop right across the street, and I asked him to find and get our 5th degree jewels, which is the same pelican and eagle thing of the Masonic Rose Croix initiations. 8 p.m. dinner at Clive and Deb's. At Clive and Deb's, broccoli and bean dish, veggie. Next day, slept until 11 a.m. and raining. Deb came home early from work. She drove us and her lady friend and her 2 girls, 6 and 7, to St. Francis Dashwood's Hellfire Club Caves in West Wycombe. So we toured the Hellfire Caves with 2 delightfully rosy-cheeked children. It was so cool. It was so cool. If you don't know what the Hellfire Club caverns are, or who Francis Dashwood was, or why Benjamin Franklin hung out with him, or how the Hellfire Club hired frisky women to dress up like nuns, topless nuns with little badges that said love and friendship. It was so charming. Okay, I digress. The Hellfire Club's in West Wycombe. Even with the rain, we toured the Dashwood Mausoleum and then back to the house for tea. Constance and I went for a late afternoon walk into Wycombe. visited a pub called the Three Tubs. Everything closes down at 5 p.m. except the pub that opens at 5:30. I could never figure out the pub hours thing. As we were nearly back to Clive and Deb's, we met the Caliph's cab. Okay, so HB's cab had just arrived, and we helped him with his bags. After dinner, we stayed up and reviewed what was prepared for the initiation and made a list of things still needed. Lots. Then off to bed. April 7th, 1989. Up for breakfast, discovered our camera didn't work. Packed up Clive's little Austin, tiny little car with all of our stuff, said farewell to Deb and Wickham, and went off for Wales around 10:30. Clear and beautiful when we departed, but clouded up and rained on the way and off, on and off the whole way. It took us about 8 hours to get to Aberdaron. Countryside, beautiful, lots of sheep, snow and sleet in the mountains. Cold, cold, cold. First glimpse of the Irish Sea and Hell's Mouth. Breathtaking. Got to the house. The house had a name. Okay, Glendaron. Before dark, met David Rietti. Wonderful character. Large bearded man, outspoken. He was the den mother. And later on, at least several times, David hosted me in Manchester, he and his family. At first sight, the house seemed entirely unsatisfactory for 5 degrees. 4 bedrooms and a bath upstairs, a long, narrow living room, a kitchen with a dining area downstairs, a cottage, which was probably the original house, attached to the back of the house with a kitchen and small living room, and bedrooms upstairs. The house is about 30, or is about 300 years old. As the evening wore on, candidates began to arrive. First was Zdenko, who had hitchhiked from Yugoslavia. Yeah, hitchhiked. Even caught a hovercraft or something, hitchhiked across the English Channel, and then all across England to Wales. It was pouring, sleeting rain, and when he came to the door, he was soaking wet, holding a backpack with his OTO dues in it. But I digress. He was totally wet, and before he sat down, he unpacked his lodge report, complete with $120 in American money. And even in those days, there was difficulty in what was called Yugoslavia, or his part of that area of the country, transporting foreign currency. Okay. He was in some kind of, or he could have been in some kind of danger, okay, for even taking $120 in cash, American cash. But anyway, the house was very cold and never warmed up enough for us to take our coats off. Clive returned from the station with Arald from Norway and the Germans. There were two Germans. Norbert and, oh, it's, I'm embarrassed, I can't remember, and Rose. And before midnight, the rest of the Yugoslavs arrived. It seemed like they all smoked. In parentheses, the absence of toilet paper gives me great anxiety. April 8th, so holy day. We froze all night, even though we had a bed with many blankets, and we slept in our clothes. The bed was ice cold, and water from rain was running down the walls and freezing at the top. No heat. The only heat in the house, if you had put in a 50 pence piece, it'd give you heat for 15 minutes. There were fireplaces, though. Okay, now I don't know if Constance wants me to share this, but I'm going to say it anyway because it. Constance, who was getting her period, completely broke down and freaked, vowing only to come downstairs to officiate at the initiations. I became furious with her. She stays in bed crying. In an hour or so, she's over it. After breakfast, not only that, but from then on, she was absolutely in control of absolutely everything and everyone. She had to sort of break through the abyss to get to the. Anyway, after breakfast, we looked around the house and decided on which rooms we would use for the initiations and the hour we will start. Now, this, like I said, this is an elaborate initiation requiring several rooms, okay, and equipment that we just did not have, and we had to scrounge around the area. We had to build things out of sheets of slate that had over the years fallen off the roof of the house. We had to build altars and things like that. Anyway, we decided that we'll use the living room with the red carpet as the red room and the kitchen as the black room. We will keep the candidates in the cottage area where they can meditate if they wish and chat if they wish. When everyone was gathered in the kitchen for breakfast, I announced that we would try to start at 5 p.m. and wanted people out of the area by noon and back in the cottage by 3 or 4 o'clock. Everyone seemed surprised there was a plan. and said anything would seem organized after what they experienced in Aachen, Germany at their force and PIs. I had gone the year before to Aachen and did 25 fourths and 25 PIs in Manchester. No, I did 25 of force and 25 PIs, or Prince of Jerusalems, in Manchester, and then went to Aachen, Germany, and did another 25 of each. Okay, anyway, David Rietti, Constance, and me then went to work to clean the areas of furniture, move curtains, and set up altars, etc. At this point, it doesn't look good. Note, on the consecration of Clive Harper. Oh, Clive, I hope you're listening. On April 7th, the day before, when Clive was driving us to Wales, for seemingly no reason, the Caliph turned to Clive and said, "Have you given any thought to the Gnostic Catholic Church?" Clive answered, "No, not really." Clive, the Caliph, then came back with, "Good. Do you want to be a bishop?" "No, not really," said Clive. "Well, think about it." Note, The only bishop at this time in Europe was somebody I'm not going to talk about, whose participation in the OTO was in terrible jeopardy. An unsuitable person to be the only bishop in Europe at the moment. So I'll skip over that because, okay, so now back to the next day, April 8th, the first day of the writing of the Book of the Law. 11 a.m. The Caliph and I walked into Aberdaron, the little town. Oh God, it was so cool. There are little shops, little sort of whitewashed shops that said in business or founded in 921. You know, we've been doing business since 921. Okay. Clive and I walked into Aberdaron to look for tack. Okay, that's the thing that looks like sort of gum that you can tack things to the wall with. And every shop we went into, I'm sure the people were, I don't know, but every time we would walk into the shop, they would start speaking in Welsh to each other. So, hopefully, I'm sure to make us feel uncomfortable and left out of the conversation. Anyway, the Caliph and I walked into Aberdaron to look for tack and a Welsh flag. Yeah, never mind. Walk near the old church by the sea. And Aunt Constance was with us here too. We saw Clive walking alone, kicking stones and picking up shells. We watched him unnoticed for maybe 5 minutes. Then Clive looked up and saw us. Ah! Ah, it's a great day for a consecration, I said. We all giggled. The Caliph and I then walked down to the bench toward Clive, or to the beach toward Clive. Arr, now we've got him with his back to the Irish Sea, I snarled. Clive backed up a little. We discussed the bishophood a little, and Clive said he was yet undecided. And then I said to the Caliph, I don't believe I've received consecration at your hands. I'd been consecrated by Hymenaeus Alpha. He said, No, you haven't. Well, fuck, I said. Then we walked down to the water's edge, and he consecrated me. And Clive took a picture. When it was over, I turned to Clive and said, Next. Clive said, Okay, but only if Archbishop Duquette helps. So I held both his hands while the Caliph consecrated him. Let's see here. The fifth degree at 5:45 p.m. The fifth degree initiations start. 10 of them. We can't believe it. The red room and the black room look pretty good. I mentioned a couple things that might be a little proprietary that were snags in the ritual. No one could believe we started almost on time. We finished some 10 hours later. I mentioned how parts of it were very bad on my back, but it really went well. Snack afterwards in the cottage. And then we read the first chapter in English because it's the feast of the first day of the writing of the Book of the Law. We read the first chapter in English, Serbo-Croatian, Norwegian, and German. And the Yugoslavs gave us a beautiful copy of their translation of the Book of the Law. And then we went to bed, slept better. People donated sleeping bags, blankets, so heavy we couldn't turn over, but okay. Have toilet paper now. Allahu Akbar. Okay, that's the April 8th. I don't know if, well, perhaps tomorrow we'll continue with the second day chapter reading of our adventure in Aberdaron, Wales, right across from the Isle of David. Anyway, that's it for today. I've got a lot of writing to do. Continue to be good to yourself, be good to each other. Do what thou wilt, shall be the whole of the law. Love is the law, love under will.